interest-bearing bank accounts dealing with compound interest. The first objective will be looking at the different types of interest-bearing accounts. We have regular savings accounts. This is generally the type of savings account you're introduced to as a child. They're easy to use. The positive is that they're liquid, which means you deposit money today, you can take that money out tomorrow. There's no time restriction on it. Because they're found at a bank, most banks are FDIC, which stands for Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation. In the event that the bank should go out of business, the FDIC insurance kicks in and will give you your money up to $250,000. The downside is they're very low interest rates. And here's a table from a bank showing what a regular savings account is, requiring that there be $100 in the savings account and they're earning a 1/10 of 1% interest rate on it. So not very high at all, but again, some of those other pluses outweigh the interest being paid. We also have checking accounts that will pay interest, which is definitely a plus, provided you have a balance in your account. And this may or may not be a positive, but to earn the interest, you need to carry a minimum balance. When that minimum balance isn't maintained, then there could be a fee assessed. So be sure when you are looking at opening up a new checking account that you check into the options and what seems to fit your financial situation. So let's look at how we compute daily interest. Sometimes we will have interest accounts, savings accounts that pay compound interest daily. We'll see them in savings accounts, passbook savings, or the checking accounts that pay interest as well. We can use the formula that we use for compound interest that we saw previously. And here is an example. If we have $500 at 4% compounded daily for 3 years, this is what the formula would look like. Here's our principal times the quantity 1 plus our interest rate as a decimal divided by the compounding period, which is daily. So we use 365 raised to the n, the number of compounding periods, 3 years at 365 per year, which results in the amount of $563.74. Or we can use a table. On the table, we would look at something that is set up for compounded daily and then the interest rate that the account is paying. Similar to compound interest tables that we've seen in previous sections, we'll pull that value from the table, which replaces the quantity that's shaded here in our compound interest formula, but leaves us with multiplying that value by the principal amount to give us our answer. Here's an example of a compound interest table for daily frequency, and it's set at a 3.5% interest rate. Very similar to the table that we've seen before. The columns in blue are the number of days, and adjacent to it is the value that we will use to replace this portion of our compound interest formula. So here we have an example, set aside $5,500 in a savings account earning 3.5% interest compounded daily for 50 days. How much interest will be earned? We could use our formula. Or using this table, we need to make sure that we're using the appropriate table. This is set for 3.5% interest and compounded daily, which is the case for this problem. So our next step will be to find the number that corresponds with 50 days. Here on the third column of number of days, we find 50. The number adjacent to it will replace this portion of our compound interest formula. which leaves us only to take the principal times that value to give us the total amount in the account after 50 days. Let's look at another one. $3,200 is invested in a savings account earning 3.5% interest compounded daily for 85 days. How much interest will be earned? We're still dealing with compounded daily and 3.5%, so we'll use this table. We're going to locate where 85 is with our multiplier. Multiplying our deposit by that value from the table gives us our total amount in the account after 85 days, but the problem is asking how much interest is earned. We will take our balance at 85 days and subtract the initial deposit to determine the amount of interest that's earned in the account. Let's take a look at maybe a more practical problem in the sense that deposits are added periodically and we're interested in what amount would be after a certain amount of time. Or maybe we have withdrawals taken. So in this first sample problem, we're going to use the 3.5% interest compounded daily. On January 1st, this bank was open and the amount of $8,756 was deposited. In February, another amount, and in March, a third amount was deposited. And the question is asking, what is the balance on March 31st? First, and ultimately, what is the interest earned? So we're going to take this as though it were three separate problems. Here we have our timeline. We need to know how many days this first deposit is going to be in there. If nothing else happened in this account, on January 1st, this amount was deposited, and we're interested in how much money that accrued due to compound interest being paid daily on March 31st. Well, if we do the calendar math, there are 90 days between March 31st and January 1st. So we'll use our table with the 3.5% interest for compounded daily. We'll find our multiplier that associates or is associated with the 90 days and multiply that initial deposit. So this would be the balance after the 90 days for just that first deposit. Then we'll go to the February 11th deposit. This money is sitting in here from February 11th until March 31st. It too will be accumulating interest, but only from February 11th until March 31st, which is 48 days. To calculate the interest earned on that amount, we will look up 48 days on our table, which this is our multiplier, times it by that deposit that's only sitting in the account for 48 days, and we have the ending balance. The last step here is looking at how long is the March 21st deposit of $650 in the account and earning interest. Well, March 21st to March 31st, no surprise, is 10 days. The interest earned on that account and the ending balance for that deposit is this multiplier times 650. Now, if we add these three values together, it will give us the balance from these three separate deposits on these different dates. That answers the first question. To determine the amount of interest, we need to take this balance and subtract off those principal deposits that were made through the course of this 90-day period. So here's what that would look like. We take our balance after the 90 days, subtract each of those three, and here we're showing that they added those three principal deposits and then subtracted that quantity from the balance as of March 31st. The result is an earning of $80.82. Here's another example where we have some withdrawals that are occurring. So let's take a look at this one. On April 1st, MVP Sports opened a savings account with a deposit of $17,500. A withdrawal of $5,000 was made 21 days later. Another withdrawal of $980 was made 12 days before July 1. Find the balance on July 1. To solve a problem with a withdrawal, we kind of reverse our thinking a little bit to calculate this. On 21 days past this initial deposit, $5,000 is withdrawn, which means that $5,000 sat there for the first 21 days before it was moved or withdrawn, and it was earning interest. We have another withdrawn made 12 days before July 1st. Doing some calculation, that means that this $980 sat in there from April 1st until 12 days before July 1st, which apparently, if we do that calculation, July 1st is 182nd day of the year, 12 days before that is 170th day, April 1st is the 91st, and the difference between the 170th and 91st is 79 days. So this $980 before it was withdrawn was compounding interest every day for 79 days. What stayed in the account the entire period from April 1st to July 1st is the difference between the initial deposit and these two withdrawals. So if you take that initial deposit and subtract the two withdrawals that were made, this means there was this amount of money that was left in the account for that time period from April 1st to July 1st. We then need to calculate what the balance is for each one of these three values. 5,000 times, we'll look up the number from our table associated with 3.5% interest compounded daily for 21 days. This is what this would have grown to. Again, for $980 sitting in there 79 days, we find the multiplier and the multiplier associated with 91 days, which is actually below the table in a little note. There's where you'll find your multiplier for that. These then are what the balances are for these accounts with their interest. We're almost done. What we need to do is add the three up, but recognize we did withdraw the $5,000 and the $980, which gives us an ending amount of $11,638.49. You could have subtracted your $5,000 off from here to get a $10.08 interest earning on that amount sitting for 21 days before the withdrawal. And if we take our $980 withdrawal away from here, it means it earns $7.45. We could have added the interest from these two onto here and still arrived at that same value.